Hello, Malty. Meshugners of March Madness. Thank you, Alec K, for that rather obscure malt mention, but it's a malt mention, I've just malt mentioned it. Malt mates, welcome to Ralfy Review 832 Extras. Extras, where I provide a little bit of extra perspective, information, opinion, bits and pieces, and assorted stuff relating to whiskey and other quality spirits. And I know that some of you are curious as to why I maintain a ban on non-age statement Scotch whiskey, when in fact quite a number of these non-age statement bottlings are of quite good quality. And I really want to clarify the situation for you once and for all, so as that you really understand where I'm coming from in this. And this really goes back to the old days in the 1980s, when I was sitting in bars in Partick in Glasgow. I write about it in my book, this one here, Search for a Whisky Bothy. By the way, thanks to everybody who's bought my book. Really appreciate it. And I really appreciate the 5-star reviews. That's really, really decent. But I'd be chatting to people in the bars who worked in the industry, and of course, these are people behind the scenes that actually do the job of production and tour guides and office admin and bottling plants and cooperages and driving lorries. And these people know an awful lot about whiskey. And because I showed an interest at a time when nobody was showing much of an interest, they were quite happy to speak to me, particularly when I'd buy them a drink. You know, it works. And one of the things they talked about was the techniques of taking a brand and, you know, if it didn't have an age statement, well, it just gave an awful lot more wriggle room for the distillers to bottle what they want. And you really noticed this in the old days with blended whiskey, not with single malt, but with blended whiskey. There were single malts that were non-age statement bottled. But these were the days when there were very, very few customers for single malts, and they didn't mind because they knew, anyway, that it would be damn good stuff. You know, the distilleries didn't have to package it as good stuff. It went on trust. Less so nowadays, because we've all been disappointed by bad bottlings. But they talked about the fact that blended whiskies, and as much as you'll see them in auction houses now and again, these blended whiskies, they've gone, they've disappeared for a very simple reason. They started out quite good and then they became rubbish. They were rotten whiskies and people stopped buying them. And the one of the reasons that Johnny Walker and Chivas Regal and Dewars maintain their reputation is because you can see that today they carry age statements. And the age statement is basically an in-house, an industry guarantee of a predetermined quality that people can have enhanced expectations, knowing that the more time in casks, the more it's going to be delivered in terms of complexity and the calibre of maturation. Now, it's different age now. You can have old whiskies that have got an age statement and they're not very good, but at least you've got more information rather than less information. And it's all rather confusing, malt mates. Even I get confused now and again, because I'm looking at some really, you know, realistic age statements, and I'm looking at the price and I'm thinking, actually, that's reasonable. It turns out it's a grey whiskey. Grey whiskey, particularly from the independent bottlers. And then you see something from the official bottlers with no age statement, but a fancier packaging, and there's marketing involved. And you look at the price and you know that it's been hyped up by 5 times what it's worth. You know, people will pay £300 for a 25-year-old single malt. But when you bottle a single malt without an age statement, just call it fine old, rare old, you know, pedigree, heritage, blah, 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 then people are going to presume that the price reflects the quality and that they can trust the distillers, that it's older whiskey in it. And sure, there may be some older whiskey in it, just enough to make it work. So much is taken in trust. And don't forget, it's not that we distrust the whiskey industry. It's just that we keep a realistic perspective that they're a commercial business, and business is like a game of chess, except it's different. You get the black squares and the white squares. And that's the game. But with business, you've got all the grey squares in between, haven't you? And nobody's quite sure about the rules of the game. It's what you can get away with. That's business, realistically. Particularly when you've got business people involved, particularly from the financial sector. What a dreadful mistake that is. Anyway, let's refocus here. Bucket of malts, bucket of whiskey. Here's a good non-age statement whiskey. Lafroig Lore. It's everything a Lafroig should be. And the most important thing is that people that bought it are excuse me a second. Medicine time. That's cleaned my palate and cleared my head. For Lafroig fans, this is everything a Lafroig should be. It's nicely presented. It's bottled at 48%. It tells you as much as Lafroig are ever going to tell you in their presentation. And it's just a good, representative, solid and decent of Lafroig, the experience. Here's another one. I'm not a huge fan of Oban. I'm really not. I'll take these out of the bottles, shall I? Boxes, sorry. I reviewed Oban 14-year-old recently, but to be perfectly honest, it's kind of an anemic malt. It's a little bit featureless and characterless Oban. It's the way it is. It's what they used to call blend filler. It's not one I rush out to, but the thing about this version, and the reason that it's proving popular, this Little Bay Oban non-age statement, is simply because they've matured in quarter casks, and quarter casks, they hold on to the freshness of the still while speeding up maturation, because your smaller casks have got a greater surface to liquid ratio in terms of cask and content, and that's what makes them work. It's worked for other people, like, for example, Springbank, Rundlets and Kilterkins. And Bruichladdie, they did quarter casks, hellish for losses. But that's a debate I'm having with my Patreon pals at the moment. Here's another one, Longrow, non-age statement. You know, it's delightful. Another peated whisky. Peated whiskies work well when they are young because the phenolics are more intact. I am not a fan of old whiskies from Islay. Not just because they're outrageously expensive, but to be honest, the phenolics died in it, and you get this kind of whisper and wispiness, and it doesn't really work. Here's another one, Arran quarter cask. Here's that quarter cask going on again. Very, very important that. Arran, consistently good quality, really got that together. Non-chill filtered, natural colour. It's got everything there but the age statement. And that's why I bought it. It's still a damn good whiskey. 125 litre quarter cask. Natural cask strength, 56.2%. And it's a belter of a session, we call a session dram. A dram that's not too expensive. It's going to get the conversation going. And it's got enough juiciness that you don't have to be concentrating and over-focusing on it to the disruption of your conversation. And finally, Highland Harvest, organic. Why did I buy this non-age statement whiskey? It's the organic thing, you see. It's not because the grains are organic. It's because they're a different type of grain from the usual, from the big grain factory. And therefore they yield a little bit more grain flavour, in my experience. And this has been bottled at 46%. Sauternes casked finish. So for lighter whiskies, it really works a treat, the Sauternes casks. I've had a lot of good experiences. So have you probably. And there it is. Lovely. I'm going to put these away now. And I'm going to tell you exactly why I don't review non-aged statement whiskies when, in fact, I do buy them now and again. And I do drink them now and again. No worries, no problems. But I won't review them. Because I'm going to put it to you this way. As malt mates and whisky fans, one of our connections to these bottles, which we open and cuddle and treasure, is sentimentality. The senses of smell and taste are emotive senses, and alcohol, when we are no longer sober, stirs our primary emotions. And one of those is sentiment. And we get very sentimentally attached. This is why we're so disappointed when we get a bad bottling. Because we feel let down, betrayed, we feel hurt. Because we are. Particularly in our pockets. But because of this sentimental attachment, we accept all the baggage that comes with Scotch whisky. The fine and rare casks. Yeah, one of 20 odd million fine and rare casks. I think it's probably up to about 30 million now. 300 million? 30 million? It's, who really knows? There's loads and loads of fine and rare casks out there. Then there's the unique bottlings. And once the unique bottling's finished, limited edition, along comes another, then another, then another. And it's always triggering our sentiment, saying, oh, this particular bottling's a bit special. I must buy it because it's special. And it's just as special as the last one and as special as the next one. It's just this theatre and culture of association which is pumped, absolutely pumped by marketing departments. The same old routine messages, the same language, the same at times, unfortunately, condescending triggering that we, the buyers, are subject to as they appeal to the demographic of their consumer within the damn category. Oh, give us a break. I'm not going to go on a rant. I'm not going to go on a rant. It is so condescending at times, it beggars belief. And then they come out with their special releases and you look at the absurdly high prices and you wonder if someone is actually paying them and you wonder if someone is already on standby to pop them into auction and then overbid on them so as to justify these high prices. What did I tell you about the grey squares and the checkerboard of business in the game of chess? Business is business. I'm neither condemning it nor condoning it. I'm keeping the stance of a cynical whisky buyer because we all have to be cynical. And we believe, because we're told, that whisky by law must be 40%. You see, let me put into perspective for you. Let me get this bottle of Little Bay, which I'm not going to open for a while. It's got caramel colour in it, you can see that. And it's chill filtered. It says in the bottle, absolute, no wriggle room here. No, we're not talking wriggle room, we're talking absolute specifics by the law statements. This is contract stuff. 70 centilitres. So 75 if you're in the US, 70 in Europe. We expect to see that. We need to know that. By law, we are entitled to know that. Percentage of alcohol. Every bottle's got to tell you what percentage of alcohol is in it. And we expect it to be 40%. But supposing they change the rules because of market expediency. Supposing they start bottling our whiskey at 38%. Do you think, come on now, do you think they wouldn't do it if they could get away with it? Many distillers wouldn't, because they've got self-respect and pride in their product. But some would, particularly when they bring in the consultants that don't give a damn about the product, but they do give a damn about the hefty fee they're going to charge for their professional services. They're going to make these suggestions. They're going to endorse these ideas, that train of thought. Well, why don't we make 60 the standard bottling size for a bottle of whiskey? Oh, no, 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 50, you know, we'll keep the 50, but we'll just make it 60 instead of 70, 65 instead of 75. These things don't happen because the industry believes that customers would not accept it, because it is a disruption of an absolute set in law regulation which helps to maintain the quality of the product. See, an age statement, when it goes in the bottle, that's another absolute. It's not the oldest, it's not the middle one, it's the youngest whiskey content, grain or malt, whatever, that's in that bottle. And when you see that age statement, it tells you absolutely clear, concise information. Sure, it doesn't tell you about the quality of the casks used, whether they're good or bad, and there's good and bad out there. And you can get an old whiskey that doesn't taste very good, but at least you know how many years it was in the cask, because it's tangible, real information. It respects the bond and the agreement with the customer who's buying the bottle. But the industry, you see, they can just drop the age statement. And do you know what they can do? They can say, well, we've got about a dozen old casks here. They're just, you know, we're sitting in a little warehouse and see the contents. The whiskey's only 10 years old, but they're so good and they've been so effective and the provenance has been so great. It tastes like a 20-year-old whiskey, despite the fact that it's 10-year-old whiskey. So, I tell you what, why don't we blend this in with some other 10-year-old whiskey, remove the age statement, right, and then price it as a 20-year-old whiskey when it's predominantly 10-year-old whiskey. And we make more money. That's the reason why they drop the age statements. You look at the non-age statements in blended whiskey at the moment, blended Scotch whiskey, and how many of them are really, the quality is deteriorating, in my opinion, and it is an opinion. I very rarely buy blended whiskies now. I just don't. And when I do, I'm looking for age statements, because it's something rather than nothing. This information is precious. We've got to guard it. The more we let the whiskey industry away with stuff, the more stuff they're going to get away with. Simples. And where does this go? You know, you're saying to yourself, hey, Ralphie, they'd never bottle Scotch whiskey at 38%. Hey, let me bring you up to date. They've discussed it. It's been discussed. Rum does it. Gin does it. Vodka does it. Go and look in your supermarket. And my goodness, cognac. The amount, the price of cognac. And you look at the nice fancy crystal decanter. And then it says 40%. 40%. Pish. Pish. Any cognac at 40% is weak. If you're buying cognac, buy cask strength cognac. That is the only way to have your cognac. That is when the personality, the character, the substance, and the magnificence that cognac can be really sparkles. But not at 40%. At 40%, it's not strong enough. It's just not strong enough. And it worries me. Because as time goes on, and I know people listen to what I say and buy in my recommendations, and then the whiskey industry, whether it be the retailers or some distillers, they can take advantage of it. And my advice to you is, as soon as you see them taking advantage of my reviews, don't buy the product. Just don't buy it. You've got plenty of choice. Buy something else. Buy some rum. Buy some bourbon. Explore. But that's why I don't review non-age statement whiskies, because I have a certain perspective which is out with the confines of sentimentality and clubbiness, which is part and parcel of the whole whiskey scene. You've got to keep a certain detachment. an objectivity. So my advice to all you distillers all around the world is, particularly the way the global economy is going at the moment, focus not just on your quality, but in the presentation of your quality. Forget your marketing people. Forget them. Frankly, you don't really need them, apart from the basics. And make sure you use in-house people. Make sure you use marketing people who've been down to a warehouse and spent a day rolling a barrel. Because these marketing people will know so much more than the office-bound, shallow consultants that are being bussed in from, or flown in from wherever, to give the same old script, the same old spiel, and the same old boring, routine, frankly, disingenuous message. Don't get me started, malt mates. Now you know why I don't review non-age statement whiskies. Because it's the thin end of the wedge. And the more that wedge is battered in between the customer and the people who care about making good liquor, the more dangerous it gets for our wallets and the quality of what we buy. It's that simple. That simple. Do you know, if you're a small distillery, if you really want to get your product noticed, put an age statement on everything. They're becoming fashionable again. Ardbeg's done it with its wee beastie, 5-year-old. I wish I could find a bottle to buy, but I can't find it in the shops. Otherwise I'd buy it and review it. But you know, it's a cracking version of Ardbeg. 5 years old, it says. Folk love it. It's a young whiskey and it works. People, the customers have grown up industry. Industry, treat your customers like adults. Thank you. That's enough from me. I'm away to put the kettle on, make a nice cup of tea and chill out a little bit. See you soon. I'm going to try to use the clicker again, but to be honest, I don't think it's going to work. It's not going to work. Something's wonky. I'm doing my best. I've tried double clickers, all the rest of it. I might get lucky. If not, I'm going to have to go up and switch this off manually. But in the meantime, I'm going to get one of these wiry clicker things. That would work a treat. I'm sure it will work. I'm sure it will work. New battery. Bye-bye now.